Good morning, everyone. Please take your seats. The program will begin momentarily.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Margaret Lowe. I'm president of Atlantic Live, and thank you for braving this incredibly soggy April day to come here this morning. But it's good to see so many of you here, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the second event in our series, Examining Modern Medicine. Earlier this year, we were in Boston to talk about medical breakthroughs from new drug therapies to technological advances transforming patient care. And our conversation today is about genomics. Scientists say we're on the cusp of a golden age of genomic-based personalized medicine, and we're going to talk about where the field is headed, potential breakthroughs, and about the societal implications of genomics. Before we get rolling, I do want to take a moment to thank America's biopharmaceutical companies. That's an initiative of our underwriter, Pharmaceutical Research and Manufacturers of America, also known as PhRMA, for making this Atlantic Forum possible. Thank you, PhRMA. And a few practical notes before we get started. Please do silence your cell phones, but we don't want you to put them away because we are on Twitter, of course, at Atlantic Live. That's all one word. We'd love you to join the conversation. Use the hashtag Atlantic Medicine. And we also want you to be part of the conversation in the room, so throughout the morning, we'll have time for your questions. In our first conversation, we're going to look at the road ahead for basic science, medical research, and innovation. And to bring this conversation to life, it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Claire Pomeroy. She is president and CEO of the Albert and Mary Lasker Foundation. The foundation is dedicated to increasing funding for medical research and to shining a light on outstanding advances that improve health. Hello, Dr. Pomeroy. And she's here with my colleague, Steve Clemens. He is Washington Editor-at-Large of The Atlantic. Steve, take it away.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Margaret.
This is so weird. I need to just, this is what I do. I move chairs. Because we have to look at each other and all of you. So thank you so much, Claire, for joining us. I just went onto your Twitter feed this morning. For those of you who are tweeting, she's at Claire Pomeroy. And the last three tweets, 40% of Americans will develop cancer in their lifetime. That was the last tweet. The one before that was in Brazil. They're having the biggest outbreak in 40 years in yellow fever. And the one before that was, after declining up until 1986, suicides have increased between 2000 and 2000. Do you ever tweet about anything pleasant?
you know, science and medical research are pleasant. They're all about hope.
Right.
They're about bringing new promise to people. And as a cancer survivor myself, the idea that medical research brings new therapies is a very positive thing. So I think it's important to raise people's awareness about the challenges out there, but it's also important to remember that science has answers.
Part of the backdrop of today is to take stock of the research and innovation system in medical sciences. We're going to have a lot of people up here talking about personalized medicine and, you know, all these things that may be just over the horizon of extraordinary strategic leaps in personal health and in the health of the country and world, ostensibly. I'm interested in how you would rate the biggest threats to that ecosystem, because Lasker and you are so involved in helping to promote medical excellence and health excellence. What are the threats that ought to be top of mind to us?
As you say, medical research is really exciting right now, and I think we need to view it as a public good, and we need to invest in it. So I'd say one of the threats is, are we adequately investing in medical research? Are we adequately investing in innovation? I think another threat is that we need to make sure that we are nurturing the next generation of researchers, giving them the opportunities to have careers in science and adequately supporting them. And finally, I think it's very important that we use evidence in every decision we make in our individual lives and as a society in the policies that we set.
So how do you think that's going? I don't mean to be facetious, but I mean, we're in a time where there were protests all over the country and in many parts of the world, standing up for science. It's not something you see every day. Mm-hmm. Not to knock all the sciences out, because not every day you get people out in the, you know, marching in the mall for science. It was kind of cool. But they must feel there's a need to. So what's your assessment of the chances you're going to get the investment, you're going to get people encouraged to go into this, and you're going to have that, you know, a healthier fact-based system?
So I went to the March for Science, and it was very validating to be among all of those people who were advocating for science. One of my favorite signs was, "So bad, even the English majors are here." but you know, the good news is that support for medical research really is bipartisan. Mm. And you can't say that about too many things in our country today, but all the polls show that there is support across the parties, across perspectives, for investing in medical research. And I think that's because each of us is touched by illness, by disease, you know, for, as you said, from everything from mental illness to cancer, and each of us and all of us face the threats of the next epidemic.
If you had an opportunity to tweak anything in the ecosystem, and as I look at it, you've got companies that are sort of in pharma land, you've got researchers you're on the board of Morehouse, I know, and you're in the philanthropy. You've got doctors and patients and practitioners, but there's sort of a equation. You know, innovators get patents for, as I understand it, 12 years. There are cost cycles. If you were to tweak and make that more efficient, healthier, and better, what would you do?
So I would give you two answers to that. The first is, it's all about partnerships. Hmm. And I think that academia and government and industry and philanthropy need to come together and work together so that we can have that full spectrum of innovation, from basic science that might be more often done at a university, all the way through translation and then R&D development, and in fact even implementation science, where we look at how these new discoveries are delivered to the public. So that would be my first answer, is more collaboration across the traditional silos. The second would be to invest in young people. Hmm. I think the move to support STEM education in K-12 and to make majoring in science something that's cool for our universities is absolutely essential. And we as a society send those messages to young people.
And you think that's not happening?
I think it's not happening enough. Mm-hmm. I'm very encouraged by some of the initiatives in STEM. But, you know, as a woman in science, I know that there are biases that women in science experience. Minorities have these same experiences. I think we need to make science and research inclusive. We need to get all of the brain power that we can involved in finding the answers through science.
How involved, hello everybody. how involved is Lasker in the genetics revolution, the genetics dimensions of advanced medical research now?
So Lasker absolutely endorses all scientific advances. I would say that it is clear to me that medicine is different because of genomics and the advances that we've made. Mm-hmm. I trained as an HIV doctor.
Right.
And when I look back at the beginning of my career, there was nothing to do for HIV patients other than to really hold their hand and support them while they were dying. And medical research was fantastic in the development of new drugs. But in the beginning, we just gave every HIV patient AZT. And some of them had viruses that had gotten resistant to AZT. Well, we got genotyping that allowed us to actually know the mutations in an individual's virus, and then we could give them the right drug for them and for their virus so that they had an increased chance of responding. That ability to genotype the virus changed everything. Those are the kind of advances that we celebrate at Lasker. And I think, and I hope, that the public celebrates because, again, it changed everything in the HIV epidemic.
We were talking backstage about infectious diseases and HIV and your journey through much of that. What do you think the most important framing lessons were that would affect? I mean, this is not a done thing, infectious disease, right? We were talking about other waves of things that could come about. What do you think we've gotten right after the HIV response?
We learned a lot in the HIV epidemic. The first thing we learned was we didn't react fast enough. And many people died because we didn't react fast enough. So we need to continuously be doing science so that we're ready to respond to the next epidemic, which is inevitable. I think the second thing that we learned...
Where do you think that next epidemic will come from, given your best guess?
Well, we know that most of the new emerging diseases come from animals, so zoonoses. But the thing is, we need to be prepared because we can't predict. There's a great deal of anxiety about, you know, the next flu epidemic. There's a great deal of anxiety about what's the next zoonotic infection that comes out of, South American Amazon forests or Africa. We just don't know. But we have to be prepared. The second thing we learned in the HIV epidemic is that empowered patients can change everything. And it was because of groups like ACT UP during the HIV epidemic that science moved as quickly as it did. And I think scientists learned to partner with patients during the HIV epidemic and understand that if we came together, we could actually make the advances faster. And then a third thing that we learned was new ways of getting drugs approved. Mm-hmm. The idea of rapid approval, which has been picked up now by the FDA and their new ways.
That's the 21st Century Cures Act.
The 21st Century Cures Act has many mechanisms in it to get more rapid approval of drugs. Now, there's always a balance between safety and rapid approval, but when patients were dying of HIV, they said, you know, I need access to those drugs. Let's make sure that regulations aren't getting in the way of delivering safe drugs to our patients.
Is the 21st Century Cures Act enough, or do we need to now go a level beyond that?
So the 21st Century Cures Act has great advances in it. It has many things. It has sustained funding for the NIH. It has rapid approval mechanisms, better ways to do clinical trials. There are many good things in there, but I don't think we can ever get complacent We always need to be looking at better ways to do science, better ways to fund science, better ways to do science, making sure we have the right regulations in place. And I'll give you one example of something I think that we need to talk about, because it will come up in a subsequent panel here, which is we really need to look at all the ethical, legal, and social implications of the science that we're doing. Some people call that the ELSI, ethical, legal, and social implications. And I think sometimes we're making these great technological advances, and yet we need to have the personal and societal wisdom of how to use those advances.
So how do you get that right? Because with all due respect, I wouldn't against it. It sounds right, the ethical, legal, social sides of science. But there's another side to it, that when information is being shared, or the need for actually more data to be shared between institutions, that it's uneven around the country. That I've heard from Sid Mukherjee and others in the cancer research area, that there's a lot of data hoarding and selfishness in the kind of Cambridge health institutions. I was talking to Bill Dalton of the former CEO of Moffitt yesterday. He said Midwest institutions tend to share more, tend to be more, commonly directed and trust each other in this. And that so a lot of the kind of data banks that are developing are in institutions not connected to sort of New England. And I'm interested in that, whether there are inhibitors because of so-called science or social and legal and ethical concerns that may actually be, in disguise, maybe self-interest.
I think we absolutely need to look at ways to tear down the walls between the silos, whether it's academic institution to academic institution. We need to look at the incentives. Academia has sometimes incentives like publish or perish, which encourage people to hold on to their own data. Industry has, the bottom line stockholder needs that sometimes cause them to hold on to data. And this goes back again, I think, to this concept that I think as a society, as members of the public, we all need to say science is for a public good. And I truly believe that most scientists go into research because they want to make a difference. They want to do good for others. When I talk to a researcher who's discovered a new therapy, say the Gleevec for chronic myelogenous leukemia, which was a cure for leukemia. When I talk to Charles Sawyers, the guy who invented that drug, his face lights up about the good that he can do for people. So I think that leadership in the institutions that you describe, every scientist, but also society needs to say, let's keep our eyes on the prize, and the prize is better health, and it's a pretty good one.
What if we made Claire Pomeroy, and we took you out of being this do-good philanthropist and made you a pharmaceutical company, and it was sort of, Pomeroy Pharmaceuticals, right? And you were out there looking at doing good, but also making money. I'm interested in this equation because I think it's very much part of this question of personalized medicine and incentives. The difference between blockbuster drugs that fix everyone and those that fix much smaller communities and address much, how do you get that equation right from a pharmaceutical company's perspective?
So, this is the challenge because industry does have a bottom line requirement to survive. And if no money, no mission, no money, right? So I think that we have to decide as a society how we want to invest in those drugs that may not be cost effective for industry. There are some interesting new models. There are nonprofits which are getting into the business of drug development, and they often partner with big pharma who have the facilities to do that. I think there are many examples where industry has said, we understand the societal need. Perhaps the classic was the use of ivermectin, where Merck shared the ivermectin to combat river blindness in Africa. Africa would never have been able to afford to pay for that drug to treat everybody with river blindness, and they said this will be our social mission. So I think that these are the balance. Sometimes we don't look at the economics correctly, too. There are drugs that have been developed that actually cure diseases. They may look very expensive up front, but let's do the economic analysis that shows not only the suffering that they get rid of, but also the fact that we don't have the costs of treating the chronic illness.
How would you tell that story in a better way? Because I hear that often, that there are these cost save in society, and we don't have this massive ledger book that society can say, okay, we have this ledger book, we're getting something right, you know, there's less cancer, or there's more people walking, and so there's more wellness. How do you get an orientation that's more holistic in telling that story? Because I know you're into science storytelling as part of Lasker, but I don't know what the killer app is in that.
So in my opinion, one of the challenges in the United States of in how we sort of pay for things is we pay for things in silos in the federal budget as well, right? And so there is this new concept called health in all policies. And if we actually looked at the increased economic productivity, the social services savings that curing some of these diseases will incur, if we had that holistic picture of budgeting instead of a siloed picture of budgeting, we could probably do great things. One classic example is mental illness. And so, you know, we have many new drugs for many people with mental illness, and yet we're still putting many of those people into the jail system instead of into the medical system. So one of the things that we care about at Lasker is that people understand the impact of these research advances, but also that we have equitable access in our society to research advances. And I think that is the responsibility of the public to ensure that there's equitable access to the benefits of research. But I do believe that it is also the responsibility of scientists to speak up about
that. Would you say that you're winning that battle on access, or would you say that you're expecting to have headwinds?
I would say there are some examples where we're winning, but there are many headwinds. And I hope that forums like this will motivate and inspire people to get out there and say, this is our value system in this country, that we would have equitable access to these things. I'll give you one example. We brought Mary Claire King to Morehouse School of Medicine. Mary Claire King is the woman who discovered the BRCA gene that puts you at increased risk of breast cancer. We gave her a Lasker for that. We brought her to Morehouse School of Medicine, and she's partnering there, a traditionally black, historically black school of medicine, to make sure that research about BRCA and access to testing is happening in the African American community. That's an example of a scientist stepping up and saying, my discovery needs to be accessible to all of our society.
Cool. Going to Lasker Prize is so cool. I just have to say, Mark Andreessen, the big investor in Silicon Valley, tweets a lot. I love his tweets, and he tweeted that most of the great innovations that will be coming out tomorrow have already been discovered and sitting on the shelf, like they were tried and shelved. And so go back and mine things. And I was fascinated by this story of AstraZeneca. Having worked, I have to read this, non-small cell lung cancer, probably all of you know this, but they had a therapy for this that failed in 90% of the people that it was applied on, but it worked on 10%. And now when you go back to this notion of personalized medicine, they're resurrecting this drug to kind of deal with the 10% of it and focus it in a way that are there. I'm interested, just because you've got such a great purview of the whole scene, how many of these things have we just gotten wrong because we tried to apply to everyone? As opposed to saying, okay, 10% were sensitive to that drug in important ways, let's go back and rediscover it. So is there an era where we can just go back to the failures that actually were successes but couldn't count that way?
So the answer I say is yes and no.
Okay.
There are clearly many drugs that only worked for a subset of patients, and when we did a trial on the whole giant group, the noise of the other subsets got in the way of showing the efficacy in the specific subset. And so we do have an opportunity to go back and look at those drugs for things like orphan diseases too, right? So I think that it is very important that we go back to the things that are on the shelf and make sure that we're adequately using them. But in my opinion, it cannot be at the expense of continuing to have that pipeline filled up with new things. And at Lasker, this is one of the messages that we sent, is that you have to be aware of the entire pipeline, the entire spectrum of medical research. The fundamental research doesn't pay off now. It pays off down the line, but it's the thing that feeds the translational research and the clinical research and the R&D. So yes, let's look back and make sure that we haven't overlooked some powerful drug, but let's not give up on inventing new ones.
Before I go to the audience for just for a few minutes, I wanted to end on something personal with you, because in reading about you and your work, and it's so impressive what you've done, you also have a complicated past. And one of the questions I have is, how does this industry that's full of data and bigger data and, you know, systems and costs and relationships and partnerships keep people at the middle of it? You were raised in largely foster homes. You left an abusive home, you know, and people talk about your strength as having come from that experience, that's why you keep people so dead set in the middle. What do you have to say to other big players in this ecosystem about how to keep people in the middle of these questions?
So I think when you grow up in tough circumstances, that's what forms your core values. And I think that as leaders and as scientists, we need to always keep in mind our core values. And for me, it's about helping the vulnerable. And I think science and medical research are the solution to many of our social vulnerabilities. But that's why I care so much about health disparities. That's why I care so much about access. But, you know, science and evidence give us the potential to find the answers to these inequities. So my advice is always go back to your core values. Know what they are and apply them every day in every decision you make. And I hope we do that as individuals, and I hope we do that as a society.
Wonderful, thank you. Let me open the floor for questions, concerns. Yes, right here. We're gonna bring you a microphone. Yes.
Hi, I'm Sandy Elsass, and thank you for your commitment to the human genome first. But what role do you see or the influence of IBM's Watson in this whole process?
So, you know, this is the era of big data, right? And no one scientist, no one scientific team could ever, like, integrate all of these data points. So the ability of technology to help us see the connections in all of these data points is so powerful. So, you know, we've gone from personalized medicine, which is finding the individual therapy, to personalized health, which is like taking this data and trying to figure out maybe even how to prevent things. And then we've progressed to this concept of systems medicine, in which we gather a whole cloud of information about you. We are going to need things like IBM Watson and technologies to synthesize that and make all of that data into real information that can be used. I don't believe that IBM Watson will ever replace your personal physician. There is both art and science to healthcare. And I think that what we're seeing now in medicine is that doctors, especially young doctors, are learning how to use technology to augment their interpersonal relationships. But nothing can ever replace, when you're feeling vulnerable because you've been diagnosed with a severe illness, nothing can replace that connection one-on-one between a patient and their physician.
Any other quick question? Who's gonna get the next Lasker Prize?
That is the one question I can't answer.
Oh, I had to ask it. Ladies and gentlemen, Claire Pomeroy, President of Lasker Foundation, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Dr. Pomeroy, Steve, thank you so much. In 2005, Francis Collins, then director of the National Human Genome Research Institute and now director of National Institutes of Health, predicted that by 2015, we will see the beginnings of real transformation in the therapeutics of medicine, which by 2020 will have touched virtually every disorder based on the understanding of the human genome. In our next conversation, we will explore how close we are to that reality and how advancements made in the field of genomics are changing medicine and our society. Joining us for this conversation, please welcome Edward Abrahams, president of the Personalized Medicine Coalition, which represents stakeholders from innovators and scientists to patients, providers, and payers. Karen Nelson, president of the J. Craig Venter Institute, a nonprofit genomics research institute. And Aris Barris is vice president of Regeneron Pharmaceuticals and head of Regeneron Genetics Center, which has built one of the world's largest genetic databases. Welcome all, and they are here with Atlantic senior editor James Hamblin, who also happens to be our in-house physician. Dr. Jim, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We have a lot of ground to cover in a half hour. We'll get to some questions at the very end, so if you can be thinking of them, writing them down. There will be 5 minutes, so they'll have to be really quick, but we'll get to some. I'm going to moderate a discussion here about the dawn of this new era of medicine. So I figured we should start a little bit at the top. I know you guys probably know most of this already. It's a pretty savvy crowd, but like we were saying backstage, Ed, a lot of people don't even know what precision medicine is, and you have done a lot of work as an advocate for public communication among scientists. So how do you concisely tell people the backstory, what it is, and the potential of it without rambling on so long that people
I'll try to hit the nail on the head and be very quick.
How do you do it in conversation, I guess, because it's a tool a lot of us could use.
Yes. So essentially, personalized medicine or precision medicine is based upon the assumption that people are different. And obviously, we've known that for a long time. But in the last 10 or 15 years, we've developed tools that allow us more precisely to understand the molecular differences among individuals. And that has, in turn, allowed us to link therapies to diagnostics, which also, in turn, produces better outcomes. And we would also argue that through personalized medicine, by making it more efficient, the health system will also benefit. So this is essentially a good thing. It gives modern medicine what medicine has wanted going back to Hippocrates. That is to be able to treat individuals according to what's going to work best for them. How's that?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds inspiring, uplifting. I should say that I am moderating at the end an ethics session, so like we're not going to delve into any the concern side of things. I wanted to, we'll talk here more about, yeah, like just like you said.
So we'll be
what's
on
the promise?
Upside.
Yeah. What is the upside here? What is the dream? And then we'll work backwards to kind of some specific things that you guys are doing to see it happen in the short term.
Can I ask Ed a question?
Yeah, please.
Oh, no.
We just met. So you're doing communication to the public, but what's your thoughts in terms of educating physicians who have to actually deal with this massive amount of data?
Well, actually, that's a great question. And we actually have surveyed physicians, and it turns out that only 10% feel they have enough genetic information in order to treat patients appropriately using genetic or genomic information. So we know that among providers, there's a lot of work to be done in terms of education. And obviously, that's even more true of the public, which is in part why my coalition was created to be an education and advocacy organization. And I would also say along those lines, and this is really a very important point, we don't get to choose the biology we have to deal with, either as physicians or patients. We just have to deal with it. And so we have to adapt our systems in order to deal with it, and that includes the entire spectrum of healthcare. We just can't ignore biology. It's a given.
So you're saying that doctors don't have enough information in terms of their own education around genetics?
Most physicians were educated before the human genome was mapped.
Right.
The overwhelming majority. So most of them don't know what a particular mutation is that is going to determine the success or failure of a treatment.
Right. So the pace of technological advancement in the field, maybe you could talk a little bit about that,
yeah.
Dr. Nelson, and
it sort of gives us an idea that these things we're talking about in the future are not so outlandish when you see how far we've come in the last two decades.
So I joined Craig's Institute, Craig Venter's Institute, about 21 years ago this year. And back then, it took like 2 years to do a microbial genome, and you know, the human genome was this massive long-term project. And now we're doing a genome probably in a couple of days, and a microbial genome in a couple of hours, and it's just, costs have changed significantly, technologies have improved so much in the past 20 years. I agree with you that most of the physicians were never really exposed to that. That's why we need to have training. So. Oh, you can't hear me?
It's like every time you turn to the right, it becomes very
hard
to hear.
I'll just look at you then. So I'm just saying that technologies have changed so much in the past 20 years from where I sit that I can only imagine that it's going to continue to advance and improve, and there's going to be massive amounts of genetic information for everybody to work with. I mean, Claire mentioned this concept of big data, but it really is a lot of information that's going to be available for, you know, an individual to play with. You know, I imagine that people are going to have their own genomes in their pocket at some point.
Yeah, and so that's what Aris is working on, making that data pool huge. Your company is Regeneron,
yes,
and you have sequenced 200,000 genomes?
Close to, approaching that, yes.
Close to?
So this is the huge opportunity and the huge challenge. So I 100% agree with both of you guys and what you said. Personalized medicine is nothing new. We've always been trying to get the right therapies to the right patients. What we do in terms of understanding disease, making drugs, treating patients is one of the hardest things we do in society. And building a foundation in the genetic code, understanding the molecular basis is going to be key to doing that. And the tools are amazing. There was a really nice article, I think Matt Herper wrote about what he called Flatley's Law. And you know, the innovation and the pace of technology, what Karen was talking about with sequencing, has far outstripped Moore's Law, what was kind of famous in terms of electronics and semiconductor industry. And I think we're at that point where we're having that kind of semiconductor moment in healthcare, where genomics, we're sequencing hundreds of thousands, millions of people, and it's now becoming more ubiquitous, routine in medicine. The challenge, though, is with all this data, how do we interpret it? And we have so much information, and we haven't yet linked all of it to causes and understanding the correlation with disease. And we have this, it's not clear-cut all the time. There are some very clear-cut examples where these mutations lead to this disease or these patients respond better, but there's so much information out there that's in this kind of indeterminate range or, you know, unsignificant findings. And I think that's going to be the challenge. How do we get physicians up to speed and providers in really understanding all this and making it actionable?
Well, can you give us one of those clear-cut examples of where something seems to be showing promise, that we're actually doing something with this genomic data that's already changing clinical medicine?
Absolutely. So I can give you a very close-to-home example. Our work with the Geisinger Health System, we've sequenced almost 100,000 individuals in that health system. And there are genes and mutations that most know about in clinical care. When you think about things like familial hypercholesterolemia or cancer predisposition, you know, BRCA1 and 2, recently made, you know, very topical, Angelina Jolie, those types of stories. And it turns out if you take an agnostic look at sequencing and a population, a healthcare system like Geisinger, it turns out that about 4% of individuals, that's a lot, have these incidental findings, things that a health system like Geisinger feels they should act on and return to these patients. And there are amazing stories, participants who've joined this study. You know, one woman, Barbara Barnes, a patient who's talked about this very public. She's a grandmother taking care of three kids. The parents are not there, and she's solely responsible for them. And she found out she had a BRCA mutation, was pretty much asymptomatic. Did all the screening and came out negative, but decided to get her ovaries removed and fallopian tubes. Turned out she had a stage one cancer. Very good prognosis that she found it then, but you know, as she says, if she wasn't in the study, didn't know about this type of information, and had waited till she was symptomatic, it would have been a very different story. I mean, she says this type of stuff saves her life. So those are clear-cut examples, and there are many of these. And there are other things like in drug development and in medicine, we look at markers, you know, like these immuno-oncology markers for these new medicines coming through that really help look at who might respond or not. But there's a sea of things far short of that where you look at it and you say, we just don't know. I mean, is that causal? Is it really going to change a patient's course?
Right. Okay. Okay. Both of you at the same time.
Ladies first.
No. Sorry. So, yeah.
Sure.
So is just following on that point, is Regeneron now developing drugs for targeted populations, subpopulations, as opposed to one size fits all, trial and error?
So we've always been trying to do that, obviously. And sometimes it just turns out that, well, we've been really a genomics-guided drug discovery and development company, whether it's been mouse genetics and now, you know, with the tools, human genetics. And so I can point to some of our early drug approvals, and these were drugs that directly followed a human genetics insight and a discovery. So they were targeting exactly kind of that genetic lesion that's causing disease. So in that sense, it's targeted and one size fits all because it's for that, you know, unique population. But yes, for other drugs that have broader indications that we're moving forward, we are constantly looking at interesting subpopulations defined by genetics or other molecular markers. And you know, one thing I think is now becoming commonplace in the industry, and it's our practice, is we are sequencing all samples from our clinical trials. We are looking at all substrata based on, you know, various pharmacogenetic markers and trying to see if there is anything there that's worth maybe stratifying, doing a prospective study, and seeing if really they should be even more specific to certain populations.
I have two quick questions.
Okay, yeah.
Do you go back and look at like failed trials at all? Like the data coming out of that? That's question one. And question, just for clarity, you're doing exomes, right? Not complete genomes, because there are other organizations that are actually doing complete genomes. But you mentioned earlier on that you're focused on just looking at the exome, and I was just wondering if you could.
So we're just in the entire genome. We look at, our approach is this is kind of getting into nuances and technical details, but we absolutely focus on exome sequencing and then genotyping,
right?
Which, you know, these days with imputation, all that kind of stuff gets you amazing coverage across the entire genome. So essentially, what we're focused on is really large effect genetics. That's the key, right? So we're not looking at things that are marginal or on the fringe.
But there's a lot of potential there, I can imagine.
There's a lot of potential,
yeah.
But we just don't know. And the genes obviously are the key to the genome and what regulates them. And so I think it's been well documented that really the genes are where the largest effects in the genome come from, and that's where we focus.
So how does the industry shift from right now wanting to produce something that has a large market to something that has a market of one person? Why would anyone ever do that? I mean, I'm not
right
a business person, but I watch Shark Tank, and they would be like, how big is your market?
Well, we don't think like that. We don't think like that at all at Regeneron, and I hope that the industry doesn't think like that. It is not about the market, and we can cite so many examples. You know, one of my personal mentors, you know, I'm a clinician by training as well and a scientist background. I was at Duke, and my immunology mentor, Tom Tedder, was involved in the cloning and discovering of CD20, which, you know, led with Ron Levy to you know, Rituxan and Biogen and Roche and all that kind of stuff. And the story of that drug having gone through so many different companies is because each company looked at the market potential, not, you know, the science and the impact on diseases, and kept tossing it around, didn't think it was right, and it was one of the most successful drugs ever. And that's happened to us at Regeneron over 30 years. We can point to, you know, several of our products where people didn't think it was a big market internally, or some of our partners, and we persisted. You really can't think about the market. It's just speculative. It's guessing it at best. You really need to focus on where's the best science, where's the biggest clinical unmet need, where can we make an impact on patients? And if, like Roy Vagelos, our chairman, and you know, our entire company believes, you know, you do well by doing good, and the profits and all that kind of stuff will follow. And that's absolutely been our mantra, and is really the only way.
This is what I meant, you have to pay attention to the science.
Yes.
The science tells us that people are different, so in order to develop drugs in the future, we're going to have to develop them more or less for some populations. And once upon a time, the pharmaceutical industry may not have been there, but now they realize they have no choice. And they are there.
Does that mean drugs are just going to cost a ton of money? I know that you know, if every article that we publish on The Atlantic was unique for every reader,
we're going to be in the future paying for value and not necessarily for volume, whereas that may have been the case in the past. So if we're paying for value and people are getting better, they're living longer, and or getting cured, society's going to benefit, and there will be downstream benefits to the health system, which won't be proposing inefficient and unhelpful treatments, which are also expensive.
Okay.
Imagine the money you could save by not giving medicines to people for whom they don't work.
Yeah, and we're not all driven by the market and the profits. I would just say that our companies, we have large dedicated workforces of scientists and clinicians and lots of other folks who are committed to making a difference. There's plenty of opportunity for financial gain and all that kind of stuff, but there's a lot more in motivation. And all of our companies have opportunities where they're probably zero, big commercial opportunities, whether it's vaccines for emerging world public health opportunities, our involvement with various antibodies for infectious diseases. There are many well-chronicled stories where there was really zero financial gain, but the motivation and the reward to the scientists and the clinicians and the companies, you can't underestimate how important that is to an innovative company and an environment of making game-changing breakthroughs and bringing new medicines forward. It is an essential part of it.
I don't underestimate that. I mean, it's just about having a viable business where, you have to, and I'm overthinking this. We're talking about a drug that's going to one person.
Yeah.
We're talking in the interim about not giving every single person the same statin or what's a realistic timeline for having drugs that are just, how many more new drugs are we going to be seeing, and how much smaller does the market get per drug in the next couple of years?
Well, part of the opportunity here is it's faster time for drug development. And the other thing is that if you can identify the subpopulation for whom it works, the effect size is demonstrated more easily. So, for example, Pfizer developed a drug called crizotinib, which only works for 4% of patients with non-small cell lung cancer because they have a particular mutation in the ALK gene. Amazing results from this drug, but it only works for 4% of the 4% of the patients.
Yeah.
And that example can be multiplied many times. And this is where the future of the industry is, and this is where the future of hope for patients is.
Okay.
So it doesn't get down to the single patient, but it does get down to subpopulations.
The global picture, we all have to deal with is, we talk about the 90% failure rates. If you aggregate all those costs, we're spending billions of dollars per drug approved. But what Ed is talking about is that math changes when all of a sudden you incorporate more effective strategies, whether it's genetics or other ways of getting precision medicine, where the success rates get better.
Yeah.
And it's cheaper and easier, more effective to do drug development. And therefore, in terms of trying to recoup those costs with pricing, you can do better in terms of pricing for value.
Okay. Can we take a kind of radical
swing?
Yeah,
I can't answer any drug questions. So.
That's fine. And there's nothing else, I think, this morning where we're talking about anything other than the human genome. And you've done a lot of work with the microbiome, which it's going to seem like having a sequenced microbiome, knowing what kind of microbes we're dealing with, is going to affect these therapeutics too.
Yeah, I would think so. So,
yeah. Where is that going to play in? I got my microbiome sequenced.
Oh, great. I can ask you about that. That's
awesome.
So,
I didn't learn a lot.
I know you didn't. So that's a great question. So I actually did the first human microbiome study in 2006. And for me, it's just amazing to see. Can you hear me? Yeah, how it's taken off on a global scale. I think there's significant potential, but I really feel like it's the early days yet because there are people like you who got their microbiome sequenced. And
I did it for journalism.
For journalism, awesome. But what did you get, like a report that said you have
two different kinds of... I might be obese and depressed.
You might be obese.
Well, we know you're not obese.
Yeah. Yeah, we did some introspection after that.
Yeah.
No, but it was like correlating, certain...
Right, but you're a physician and you don't really understand what it means, right?
Yeah.
And it's a single time point and it probably depended on what you had for breakfast that morning.
Yeah.
So I think as a community, we're really in the early stages. A lot of the studies that have been done have been on cohorts of 30 to 100 people. You're trying to extrapolate to the rest of the globe, and I really think a lot of work remains to be done, but I do feel that there's significant potential there. I think in terms of developing new diagnostics and therapeutics, we definitely will learn from the microbiome. And you can look at healthy people who live to 105, and they might have unique species that can benefit the rest of us. So a significant potential there. There's some correlations with some diseases that seem pretty robust. But in general, you know, a lot of people are like you. I got it sequenced and not quite sure what it means.
So what this company, Ubiome, is doing is sort of acquiring then tons of data from everyone who pays to get it sequenced. And then if you can correlate that with lifestyle and medical records and whatnot, you can eventually start to tell people. But there's this constant race in human microbiome sequencing, in human genome sequencing, in microbiome sequencing, where you need to buy in, you need people to give the data, and then also you don't know exactly what to tell them to do with it yet. So how do we...
Right.
We've got 2 minutes left. How do we navigate that responsibly?
I think
and
that...
And then we'll go to questions.
Okay, so I think that there are a couple of companies out there, and I'll put a plug for human longevity, where we're actually sequencing everything that's there. Some of the companies you're talking about are just looking at a single phylogenetic marker, which is not telling you about everything that's in your system. And I think we need, as a community, to move away from that and really try and correlate the microbiome with the genome and look at those kinds of correlations. And I think that that's where the future is headed.
Just get as much data as we can.
I don't know if we need, I think we need reliable, clean data.
A lot of reliable data.
Reliable.
Really hard data.
Yeah.
Right, right. And don't try to make too much of it at the beginning.
You're not obese.
No. I'm not. I might have a propensity for it.
I could have told you that without you paying for that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, so that's why, yeah, the physician's clinical exam is still important.
But I think it would be great for physicians to become aware of the microbiome concept.
Because are they not?
A lot of people are really excited about having stool sequenced. I have no idea why. I get the most bizarre phone calls. And I think that that's not, the physicians need to be able to have this conversation with their patients about what it could mean or could not mean.
Oh, yeah. So you tell people that it's worth doing right now, other than to contribute to the greater good of our later knowledge?
If they're going to do it, I suggest that they do the complete metagenomic sequence and try and see if they can integrate it with their host genome and look at relationships that way.
Okay.
Something along.
Okay.
I think it's very much a research effort. I mean, the question was, is really not much that I'm aware of that's kind of clinically actionable.
Correct.
So,
right. That's absolutely correct.
Yeah. You're sort of paying for the opportunity to contribute to... to research, which is cool if you can get people to do that. Can we go to questions? We have 5 minutes. Yes.
Hi. I just have a question. Actually, from the patient consumer standpoint, what are the options to actually getting your genomes, you know, the gene mapping done? Because most doctors don't talk to patients about this at all.
There's several groups out there where you can. There are several groups out there where you can actually get your genome and your microbiome sequenced. I think the concern is what you do with the data. Right. If your physician doesn't have exposure to genomics, you know, like what's going to happen there? So that's the conversation. But there are places that you can get your genome.
It's like 23andMe is the
Human longevity is another place where you can go and get your genome and your microbiome.
There are times when it will be clinically indicated, and that's you know, a small fraction of the time. And then from a direct-to-consumer standpoint, 23andMe was mentioned. You know, Human Longevity, I think, is doing these kind of executive genomes as well. But the challenge is, what do you report back, especially when you're not in a healthcare kind of provider setting? Like we all just talked about, it is very hard to interpret and understand the consequences of what this information means. So I think that's a challenge.
Yeah, we'll talk about that a little bit more in the ethics session too, because there are a lot of things.
The issue is clinical utility.
Clinical utility.
But some of it is.
Is this a good use of
especially resources? If you're going to sequence a cancer tumor to figure out what's likely to respond.
Right, but a lot of it is actionable. But you probably need a physician who can help you interpret what it means.
Right. Yeah, that's kind of the argument with like direct-to-consumer marketing and 23andMe, and it seems like most physicians are saying that's maybe best to be done in collaboration with a physician rather than just choosing to do it on your own.
But as you were saying earlier, most physicians were trained prior to this, so that they really don't, do they see the value, would they even suggest it? I mean, so how does that, you're sort of caught as a patient.
Well, it's an educative process. It depends if you're dealing with a sick patient or you're dealing with a well patient who gets
tested by 23andMe, so there's a whole spectrum of things. And this is an emerging field and emerging science, and its clinical utility is still being determined. So, I mean, that's the exciting thing about what we're talking about. We're really on the frontier of science and medicine.
Okay, another question back there.
Hi, thank you. Amy Raskin from Chevy Chase Trust. I have three questions, a three-part question.
Could we do just one of them?
We've only got 2.5 minutes.
Okay, well, I'll throw them out there, and if we choose to answer whichever is easiest. But you said 4% of the people have actionable results right now from getting their genome sequenced. What could that number be? I mean, we recently saw the Novartis test for the Alzheimer's, gene related to Alzheimer's. Do you think that number is going to be significantly higher in the future, where we'll have more actionable results? And then there was an earlier question about Watson. Are you using Watson to analyze your data? And then my final first question was, do you view the NovaSeq, or for everybody, do you view the NovaSeq platform as a game changer and an accelerator?
Okay, any of those strike a particular chord?
Yes to the last.
Yes.
No to Watson.
Same on those two. And then on the first one, absolutely.
Yeah.
It has to increase. So,
do you have an idea of what it could be?
I have no idea. But the 4% number is actually things that are really actionable. So there's way more than that that is meaningful. But if you're going to actually work with the patient and change maybe their course of their care, those things are for instance, 76 genes that Geisinger Health System selected that they are very confident in, that they feel they need to return to patients, and that they would do something with their patients about their care.
That was remarkably concise for three questions. Can we get one more question?
Let's get three more.
Hi, I'm Ken Habarta from Sparks and Honey. Ed, you mentioned in the beginning that we're kind of stuck with the biology that we're given. I feel like with the speed of technology and, again, the speed of access that we have, in the previous talk, she talked about the ability to kind of change our sequenced DNA, which would be like designer babies, is kind of where I'm heading towards. And as that kind of technology speeds beyond our comprehension, where, as a layperson, where do you see like CRISPR and the ability of having that fall into just people's hands?
So the technology we're referring to, it gets to gene editing and ability to change our genetic inheritance, and that's pretty powerful.
And you have 10 seconds.
But in 9 seconds, I just want to clarify that when we're given a biology, I mean, human biology is something all of us have to deal with, not at an individual level, but collectively when we develop drugs or put in place reimbursement systems or regulatory systems. We have to understand that the principle of human heterogeneity is there to stay.
We will be talking more about that in a later session, about editing and the ethics surrounding that and questions about using it responsibly. Thank you so much to the panelists.
Thank you, Edward, Aris, Karen. Thank you, Jim. We're going to flip the next two sessions. So next up, the business of human genomics. This session is produced by our underwriter, Pharma, and it will explore the demand for genomic-based medicine. For this conversation, please welcome Robert Hugin, Executive Chairman of Celgene, and CNBC reporter Meg Turrell, who covers all things biotech, and she is here to lead the conversation. Thank you.
That was super, super fascinating. So many different things to talk about. We only have 10 minutes, so we'll dive right in. I was just asking Bob, actually, if he'd had his genome sequence when we were standing in the hallway, and you said...
Yes, I did. It was part of a physical. And actually, some usable things were found about clotting proclivity, et cetera.
Me too.
Yeah.
Factor V Leiden?
Yes, exactly. The Northern common. European warrior clan that...
Maybe we're related. We should do our 23andMe's and see if we can connect them.
Exactly.
So we're talking about this from a business perspective, and I guess, you know, let's start broadly. I mean, where do you see the biggest opportunity coming from having sequenced the genome almost 15 years ago?
Well, I think the benefits in for the general population is that it really is affecting things today and obviously for the long term. The most significant change is, I think there's a renewed optimism that we're going to really make a difference in the incredible, intractable diseases of the aging, Alzheimer's, metabolic disease, cancer, and so and that whole retooling of the R&D infrastructure in America over the last 15 years is now showing the promise why we have thousands of new drugs in development today because of that retooling and the fundamental science that was done through the mapping of the human genome. So that's clearly the long-term benefit. That is so significant because if we don't deal with those issues in the next 10, 15 years, the cost of just caring for Alzheimer's patients and cancer patients, metabolic disease of the elderly, we're going to undermine the economic fabric of our society. There will be no discretionary spending. So it's such an imperative that we take this technology and apply it in a way that really solves these social issues. On the near term areas, I think we've seen tremendous impact on patients already. There are more than 100 approved drugs by the FDA that have genomic information and labeling that provides either specific patient populations or how to use the drug in a way. So patients today, because of the science advances that have been made over the past decade, are significantly safer, being treated better, not being treated with the drugs they shouldn't be treated with. They're being used more effectively from dosing regimens, et cetera. And therefore, quality of life is even better, if not, in fact, extension of life has been achieved. So, and you heard earlier, I think one of the other benefits that's happening is that the reality of it is that we have to make sure that we're more efficient in how we deliver our, or develop our drugs, and therefore we've got to use the technology to ensure that we have the highest probability of only testing drugs in the people we believe scientifically and medically that they're going to work in. And so therefore that should help us reduce the costs, compress the time it takes to get drugs approved. So I think there's near-term benefits that we've already gained in our society because of the investment in what we've done here, both the public and the private sectors, and the medium term and the long term, it gives us promise, and it's an incredibly exciting time to be involved in trying to attack some of those long term issues.
Well, I remember the speech that Bill Clinton gave when the genome was sequenced, and you're talking about curing diseases like Alzheimer's, cancer, and a lot of people kind of expected that to be, you know, around the corner, immediate. And, you know, when it comes to Alzheimer's especially, we are nowhere close, unfortunately. Where would you say we kind of are versus expectations, you know, in that progress toward actually solving some of these things?
Yeah, I think it's a fair question, a fair commentary that, you know, some of it was discussed in the earlier panel, that the part of the progress has been really breaking down the patient populations to really understand the targeted populations, whether it was the ALK, non-small cell lung cancer, we talked about crizotinib and Pfizer and the issues. We have a drug that was approved for myelodysplastic syndrome that only for people that have a specific chromosomal deletion in the 5q area. So we're making good progress, and part of the progress is we're reducing, there isn't one breast cancer, there's hundreds of breast cancer. So the ability to really redefine disease and then for attack it in its fundamental genomic proteomic initiation, that we can really cure, the much more significant progress made it. And I think that's going to be the continuation of the trend. We all are hoping for a silver bullet of immunotherapy or stem cell therapies, and we invest an awful lot of money in those. We're very excited about the promise of still searching for the silver bullet, but part of that silver bullet is really breaking the populations down to really understand these are different diseases, different causes, and can be treated differently, and that's the reality of it. And that's, I think, a part of the multi-pronged approach that we're all taking to attack the disease most effectively.
So there was some interesting discussion on the last panel about cost and whether these personalized therapies, will be even more expensive because a smaller market means you have to charge more, kind of like the orphan drug business model. How do you look at that, and what will bring costs down ultimately?
Yeah, no, I think it's a very important issue. Our society has fewer, more, not many more significant issues to challenge, but the cost of caring for aging population versus the pace of innovation to deal with for solutions that it's a fundamental social issue in all the developed world. We've got to deal with it, and this is part of the solution. I think we have to recognize that we've got to make the investments now. We've got to figure out how do we make it more cost-effective. There were some of the conversations that were discussed earlier. We need to make data more interoperable so people really can share the kind of data that's available so that we're not reinventing the wheel. We did a deal with a collaboration with Columbia, Mount Sinai, Johns Hopkins, University of Pennsylvania, the cancer centers there, that they would collaborate on everything but the basic invention. We still want competition for the basic invention, but then they shouldn't redo the the biostatistics, the analytics, the data analytics, et cetera. So they share that, and they share the intellectual property, and they'll share the royalties if we ever produce a drug out of the initiative. So we've got to redefine the way we think about R&D to be more collaborative, which was talked about earlier, to reduce redundancy, not lose the American competitive spirit, because that's one of the great reasons why the whole ecosystem of biomedical innovation is headquartered in the United States, is because the environment is so positive for that kind of collaboration and competition, but people really producing great results. So from an economic point of view, I think we also have to be very careful that as we think about how do we manage these costs, and we have to be more effective. Earlier talked about value drug pricing, et cetera, something we absolutely support, that we have to recognize the economic growth in America of the last 60, 70 years is 50% of the growth in GDP has really been contributed by the advances in public health and science and medicine to what we do. And so we've got to be careful that we don't lose one of the great crown jewels of the United States economy, and a benefit to its citizens is the whole ecosystem of biomedical innovation. So we've got to find these solutions. We've got to talk more aggressively about them. I think I'm more optimistic now that in the last couple of months, at least we're having a debate and an integrated discussion. People are listening and saying, how do we attack both the issue of how can we afford the healthcare system that we want, but yet at the same time invest for the future to solve these terrible problems we have as a society? It's not going to be easy. No one's ox is not going to be gored. We've got to do it in a way that produces long-term best solutions, and in a way that everybody's at the table and engaged in it. And the other thing, I apologize for pontificating about a little bit, but I think we've got to stop calling it healthcare Obamacare and Trump care. Healthcare, it needs to be changed every 1 or 2 years, because the world is changing and the dynamics change, and we've got to continue to refine the way we think about public policy and managing healthcare, both from a government and a private sector. And when we make it so partisan because we attach these names to it, it makes it harder to do the kind of evolutionary change that we need to make every single year. And we have to stand up and fight this and say, no, this can't be changed every 8 years. Healthcare needs to be refined on an ongoing basis. And hopefully the discussions that we're having now will start to begin that process. But it's one that is, we have very serious consequences if we don't recognize this has to go. It's always going to be political, but we've got to lessen the partisanship of it, in my opinion, if we're going to produce the kind of really effective reforms that we need.
Well, I think that's a really interesting idea. One of the questions that comes about with healthcare reform or anything really is who pays for it? And so I want to ask you, when you think about how we learn more about the human genome and try to apply that, and we see things like the Precision Medicine Initiative, but also these amazing projects folks like Regeneron are doing, do you think it's a company thing? Should it be a privately funded thing? Should it be a government-funded thing? And then you have, you know, Trump's proposal to cut the NIH budget by about 20%. So how does that work?
No, I think we have to look at things holistically. I think that we have many great examples of pre-competitive partnerships, that the collaboration is important, that we have to be competitive for the invention. That's what really gives the great breakthrough, is the individual lab, whether it's in a academic institution or a company or wherever it is, that great invention needs to be made, and we want as many people focused on that as possible in our own little world. But things that are not necessarily fundamental to that invention, we've got to reduce the redundancies. We have to collaborate. We cannot afford to do the kinds of costs that everybody doing everything in a different way. So I think the issue is that we want to retain the character of our system, which has provided the kind of advances we've had. And you think about, people don't appreciate the great successes that we've had with cardiovascular disease, with AIDS. My kids don't even know there was ever an AIDS epidemic. We have really transformed the way the world thinks about medicine. We've got to retain that, but at the same time do it in reality of the economic world that we live in today.
Well, we are just out of time, but I'll ask you one more question if you don't mind, which is CRISPR. How soon do you see that, and do you, in what role do you see it playing in actual drug development and being used in people?
Yeah, we're certainly a significant investor in there, and we have 70 different programs involved in genomic, proteomic drug discovery, and CRISPR is probably involved in 10 of those different programs. Our view is, I think, that we've got to be careful, that we've got to really understand to find the nearest term practical, most serious diseases that we focus on, because the unintended consequences are still not completely known. So we're incredibly optimistic about it, but like all of the advances, we want to get very excited about it, we want to make sure we invest in it, but we've got to be sober about the prospects of it. But it's a great tool, and we're hopeful that it's going to play a meaningful a role in kind of discoveries over the next few years.
Bob, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Meg. Thank you, Robert. And thanks again to Pharma for that session. Next, the future vaccine. According to the World Health Organization, an estimated 2 to 3 million deaths are prevented each year because of vaccines. In fact, WHO has declared this week World Immunization Week. It's a global public health campaign. So it's fitting that our next conversation will focus on how viral genomics is deepening our knowledge about infectious disease. It's my pleasure to welcome Ripley Ballou, Vice President of GSK Vaccines, who oversees the Slowey Center for Vaccines Research, and Mark Feinberg, President and CEO of the International AIDS Vaccine Initiative. And back to lead the conversation, my colleague, Atlantic's Steve Clements.
Hey, everybody. I have a phone here to auction, if anybody would like. Here we go. What could I get off of this? Here we go. Thanks, folks. Guys, thanks so much for joining us. Rip, I started out reading both about you, but I love this story written in the Baltimore Sun about 18 years ago. And it's a story of him standing out in a kind of by the croquet nets or the, you know, and having some home-brewed beer. Which they made before the genome was sequenced. And you basically had this massive shock because you had submitted yourself 2 weeks before to be bitten on the arm as mosquitoes filled their bellies with your blood. I'm quoting the paper in that. And your first effort at that time at a malaria vaccine didn't work because you got ill. And I'm interested, just to start out, given what science has done and given that the World Health Organization on Monday announced a major, major possibility of the deployment of a huge new malaria vaccine, how have times changed since you were a human guinea pig for this? And is there anything else you'd be a human guinea pig for today? but how has what we're talking about today changed that game?
Well, you know, this I've been involved in malaria vaccine development for about 30 years, and it's really taken us 30 years to get to the point where we actually have the potential to introduce a vaccine in sub-Saharan Africa. At the time that we began this, the tools that were required to this clearly required the beginnings of the genomic era, so we had molecular biology tools. The fact that we were able to make that vaccine was because someone was able to sequence the full a complete gene from a parasite, the first time it had ever been done, folks at the NIH. And that really directly led to the discovery and the ability to make a vaccine that was eventually successful. Now, I was just at a conference at Johns Hopkins yesterday where we were reflecting on what we have learned from that phase 3 study, where we actually took every parasite that came from every child that was infected. 16,000 children participated in this, and sequenced the parasite genome for every one of those parasites. And this gives you the real ability now to drill down and understand how is the vaccine working, how can we make it better, and this is clearly going to lead to advances to improvements against malaria.
You know, Mark, we were talking off stage, and some folks were telling us that the vaccine arena is one of those that many people look as the sleepy part of the drug business. You were at Merck for many years. Now you have the International AIDS Vaccine Initiative, which, by the way, if you guys haven't looked at their website and YouTube video, it's stunning, because I was looking at the fact that 420,000 people died last year from malaria. 40 million people have died of AIDS, 1.2 million last year. And so it's staggering, you know, we're talking about consequential things. But before you get to the AIDS stuff, you guys were competitors. I don't know if we could make an HBO show out of it, but you were at Merck, you were at GSK, you both worked on malaria vaccine, you both worked on Ebola vaccine, you've been at each other's, you know, kind of clip. So do you love each other, or is it a deep rivalry?
No, I think we both share a common commitment. I mean, we believe in the power of vaccines, and we believe in the power of science to improve the human condition, and I think both RIP, and I also, you know, strongly believe in the ability of, you know, partnerships to address problems of, you know, low-income countries where these diseases have their greatest impact and where the typical market forces would not drive investment to enable products, whether it's drugs or vaccines, to be available.
So you just said typical market forces wouldn't drive you there. Does that need to be fixed in some way? Is that a market failure more broadly as you look at something like Ebola?
No, it's a market failure. I mean, there is a commercial aspect to it, but there's also a failure of imagination about how you can make it possible for different stakeholders. I mean, so academics are great at certain things, you know, NGOs are great at certain things, pharmaceutical companies are great at certain things, but you're only going to get a solution to these complicated problems that, you know, there's an economic issue, there's a scientific challenge, there's a uncertainty challenge that no one sector can really take on by itself, and it's only by finding new ways for the different sectors to work together. So,
but to go back to the science for a minute and to Ebola, for instance, because I know you both worked on trying to reach very rapidly in 10 months an Ebola vaccine, and you succeeded, and today you can't, it's not out there licensed and easily gettable. So is that a failure of government? Is that a failure of the policy apparatus? And what did science allow you to do in that case?
Well, I mean, you know, science and genomics make it possible for, you know, contemporary vaccine development approaches to take place. We would be nowhere. I mean, earlier vaccines were developed by empiric methods. You had an idea, you like would grow a virus in tissue culture to try to attenuate it, or you would kill it and you would inject someone and see what happened. You know, that would be an empiric approach. Now it's much more predicated on very high resolution science. And
is that what they call reverse vaccinology?
Well, reverse vaccinology is one element of it, where you understand the genome of the pathogen and try to identify potential targets and then elicit immune responses against that. But it's actually much broader now. So work we at IAVI are doing and our partners are doing is really understanding in detail the human immune response to HIV infection, understanding which people make what seem to be protective immune responses, and then use high resolution structural biology, which is totally enabled by genomics, to really make vaccine candidates that are different and specifically designed to elicit the protective immune responses, which normally don't occur very frequently in infected people. So we would be nowhere without science, but we wouldn't be anywhere without, you know, multiple partners working together to make this happen, because the work that made this high resolution science possible started out in, you know, villages in Africa where individuals are at high risk of infection, and you understand those people, you understand the dynamics of the infection, you understand how the virus is transmitted, how it evolves, how their immune system responds to it, and those individuals allowed us and our collaborators to identify protective immune responses that are now guiding vaccine development. So it is this connection between, you know, field research, which Rip is very familiar with, to the laboratory, which he's also very familiar with, and those connections don't happen by accident. And I think there are a lot of positive precedents, and the Ebola response was one tremendous one where groups of stakeholders came together, many of whom had never worked together before.
Both worked together on that.
Well, we worked in parallel programs, but we were both doing everything we could to develop a vaccine as quickly as possible. There had never been an Ebola outbreak as bad as the one in 2014 to 2016, and people thought that it might actually end up getting much worse than it actually did. So there was a real rush to do something that had really not been done before, is develop a vaccine in time to bring an epidemic to an end in that same epidemic rather than preparing for future ones. So it was a unprecedented response. And as you said, you know, things have slowed down because it's fallen from the headlines, and there is a relationship, as you at The Atlantic know, between public awareness, you know, media coverage, and action, and that happens in science too.
But, you know, it's not all negative. This you mentioned reverse vaccinology, and it's not just pie in the sky. I mean, this tool, which
could you, for the folks watching online, sort of take us down that path?
For reverse vaccinology, we are talking about taking the sequence of a, in this case, a bacteria, the bacteria that causes meningococcus B meningitis, a very complex organism for which many academic scientists and companies had worked for decades to try to produce a vaccine unsuccessfully. But about two decades ago, really with the beginning of the genomics revolution, working with Craig Venter, Rino Rapioli from the GSK worked with him to sequence the entire genome of this bacteria and then use that information to select from hundreds of potential proteins that could be used to make a vaccine to find those few that were really going to make a difference. This allowed the creation of a vaccine, which is now saving the lives of millions of children. It is a real delivery on genomics.
What would you say, and you know, I'm interested in the pipeline in GSK, and I know you're no longer at Merck, but what would you say are some of the things that we might see in the pipeline that would be surprising to us?
I mean, if we go back to the learnings that we've had from this Ebola outbreak, one of the things that has been very clear is that we need to be able to respond very quickly. What really keeps me up at night in terms of future threats is the one that we don't know about. And it's out there somewhere or will be out there as evolution moves these viruses, they're usually viruses, along. And so our ability to respond quickly and to be able to produce a vaccine in this case quickly really relies on this technology and the ability to sequence a virus very quickly, to take that information and actually put it into what we refer to as platform technologies that allow the rapid production and scale up of a new vaccine. And we're working with one that we refer to as SAM, self-amplifying messenger RNA. Messenger RNA as a way of delivering new vaccines is an incredibly exciting new area. It's completely synthetic. It allows the ability to scale up massively, quickly, and using very standardized processes, which will shorten the time and reduce the cost of development of vaccines. It's new technology. It's something that we're actively working on, and I think really holds big potential for responding not only to epidemic diseases where we don't know the target yet, but for other diseases where it's been very, very difficult to develop vaccines because of the complexity of doing it.
You know, we've had a lot of coverage since the Trump administration has come in on alliances, on strategic alliances, how to deal with Russia, how will Germany and the United States, the UK be on the same page, or how to deal with North Korea. And it's made me think about what is the state of our healthcare alliances out there? Because they don't get as much attention. When you have breakouts in Hong Kong or China or Southeast Asia or Africa or Latin America, Zika, what do we need to do that we're not doing right now to have the same sorts of strategic alliances on the global healthcare front?
I mean, I think one of the good things is that we've had, and we all saw this in the Ebola, tremendous goodwill. People stepped up to the plate, companies stepped up, regulators stepped up, the global health agencies, but it wasn't very coordinated. And it had the feeling like, well, okay, we're going to deal with this now, but it's a one-off. And I think, you know, Mark, you've lived through this. What do we do next?
I mean, what would you do different, Mark?
Well, before I get to that, I'd like to address a different aspect of your question.
Sure.
So you're talking about alliances in science, and when you think about alliances in science, the world's protection against emerging infectious disease threats and existing infectious disease threats like HIV depends on the response of the United States government. The Ebola response would not have gotten anywhere near as far along, and we would not have been able to achieve the success we did without the support from the US government and the partnership of key US government institutions, including the NIH and the CDC. As we think about, you know, protection against, you know, important diseases like AIDS, you know, the PEPFAR program has transformed global access to HIV treatment, and Claire Pomeroy referred to this
in the first session, and you know, programs at USAID, the US Agency for International Development, both support a lot of HIV work, as well as, you know, really work in the emerging infectious disease threats to like let us know what is the next over the horizons to screen animals using so-called metagenomic approaches to understand which viruses are out there that we don't know about so we could be prepared for them, and importantly, the investments in the NIH. And you know, in current discussions in Washington, all of those programs are under threat. And if all of those programs are under threat, the United States government's leadership is going to be markedly diminished, our long-term credibility will be lost, and importantly, a lot of the progress that we've made in global public health will be reversed, and that is like really tragic and horrifying to think
about.
That's
your up at night issue.
That's, yes, if you ask me what worries me the most, we are on this verge of, like you've heard it in every speaker today, the, you know, this transformation in medicine and in public health. And if we back off on, you know, investment in science, if we back off on our investment in, you know, global health, then much of that progress, it will be a missed opportunity that people will regret for a very long time.
The first line in the International AIDS Vaccine Initiative video I watched a little while ago, Alex, says, what if, you know, what if your children just saw AIDS as something in the history books? What do you see as either the political or technological barriers to actually make that happen?
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's been, and you know, Claire alluded to this in her comments, there's been tremendous progress. So the IAVI was founded in 1996. The discussions that led up to it took place at a time when there were no effective treatments for HIV. Now there are. There was no imagination that you could get those therapies to people living in low-income countries and that they would allow people to live healthy, normal lifespans, which was inconceivable at the time. And you know, clearly there's a need, it was recognized at that time, for a vaccine to end the epidemic. And clearly we now have additional modalities, you know, treatment, so-called pre-exposure prophylaxis, where you give antiretroviral drugs to people who aren't infected to protect them from getting infected. But you know, we're going to need a vaccine to end this epidemic. That's very clear. The major challenge there, I mean, is really a scientific one. We've never made a vaccine against a pathogen like HIV, and the only way we're going to get there is by state-of-the-art science, and in that regard, genomics is a key element to that. There would be no path forward without insights from the genomic revolution. So what's happening now is something that's never been done in vaccinology before. It's really sort of taking all of those basic insights about the virus, about the host, and using that to design a specific kind of vaccine to elicit a specific type of immune response, which we think will be protective. If we're able to do that, that would not only be the path to an effective AIDS vaccine and the end of AIDS, it would be revolutionary more broadly for vaccines for other infectious diseases.
Can I ask you a slightly personal question? You're now an NGO leader, major global national NGO leader, and you used to be in the private sector side of research and development on these issues. Do you look at someone like Rip and GSK, not him personally because he's a decent, cool guy, but that industry is someone I know you need to partner with, but what are the points of tension between what you need to have done and how companies in this field are operating?
Yeah, well, that's a great and important question. So, I mean, you have part of my CV. So I work as the head of a not-for-profit product development partnership now. I used to work at a pharmaceutical company before that. I worked in academia, and I've spent time working for the U.S. federal government.
We all have trouble keeping a job.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I was hoping you wouldn't bring that up. No, but I've seen this issue from multiple perspectives,
right.
And for me, there's so many missed opportunities for collaboration between different sectors. And I think the heart of the problem is that different sectors don't understand both the possibilities and the commitment of people and the limitations on them. So, you know, there was a commentary earlier by a pharmaceutical representative talking about how much people in pharma companies care about doing things to improve health outcomes and doing the right thing for individuals and the public. I totally agree with that. And you know, that's true for academics, that's true for government people as well. So they all have that common view. So it just comes down to an understanding of like what gets in the way of something like a pharmaceutical company being able to contribute. You know, they can't just drop everything and focus on an emerging infectious disease. That's basically what happened with Ebola. And I think that was really a profound reflection of the commitment of pharmaceutical companies to do the right thing, but it also highlighted that the current system doesn't work. They can't be asked to do that again and again, and we need new models of partnerships.
Rip, can I ask you the same thing, but from the other side? That, I mean, you put yourself, your body on the line, literally, on trying to find a malaria vaccine. It's very commendable and scary to someone like me, but it's but thanks for doing all that. When you look at the NGO community that's out there trying to get some of this stuff right, what do you think they need to know better than they do about some of the drivers of your industry and R&D?
And again, just in full disclosure, in that 30 years, the first 15 years, I was a government scientist working
at Walter Reed,
working in the U.S. Army. Yeah. I went to industry, and during that 15 years in industry, I also spent 2 years at the Gates Foundation. So I have seen, like Mark, I have seen this from different perspectives. And I think, particularly in the area of vaccines, what is not easy for people who are not doing, who actually in the ground working on vaccines, is to understand the time scale associated with it. The time scale. Mm-hmm. The time that's required to go from the initial discovery to the licensure of a vaccine, in the best of conditions, is still a decade. Now, we may be able to do better in the future, but it takes vision. It takes the ability to be there for the long haul.
Should it take 10 years when we can now sequence the genome and the things you've said? Do the methodologies that we used to have fit a different world? Do they need to be rethought for how fast things can happen?
Just to show you how quickly things have changed, we can take from de novo genomic information to a actual product in a vial using this new platform I referred to, SAM, in a period of about 3 weeks. And you actually have something in the vial that you
can. So that 3 week thing still is a 10-year process.
Why? Because to turn that into a product that is licensed, that is available, still requires the full process of clinical development and all of the, and it's very much driven by a regulatory system that is there to ensure that vaccines and drugs are safe and effective. It's very important. That process has not kept pace with the technology that allows us to bring new potential products to the point where we can begin to have the testing. I think when you're trying to develop a vaccine against a prophylactic vaccine, you are trying to protect people from a relatively rare event. You still need to do large trials in order to be able to demonstrate that the vaccine has efficacy, and you need large numbers to confirm safety. So those are things which are going to be very difficult to compress. I'm not saying that it's that new technology can't help us do it, but it is still a long road. And what I have found working with partners is that it's hard to sustain the energy and the commitment over that long period of time. People change, interests change, priorities change, and this is a long-term investment.
What would life be like if Venter hadn't succeeded? I was just listening to Karen Nelson up here a minute ago. It sort of blew me away. What if that had not happened? What would we be dealing with?
Well, Mark and I probably would be doing different roles here.
Well, we would be, in terms of vaccines, you know, there's a wonderful history of vaccine development that goes back, you know, hundreds of years, literally, and it's really remarkable that what people accomplished with sort of kind of minimal scientific insights. But I think those empiric approaches kind of came to the end of the road, and really for developing vaccines against the infectious agents that we currently don't have vaccines for, or thinking about how to use vaccines for, say, cancer immunotherapy or treatment of other diseases, we wouldn't have a path forward without the genetic revolution. That seems pretty clear to me.
Just before I go to all the audience, I want to ask a question. I'm just reading as well in this week. It's WHO World Immunization Week. There have been a lot of announcements this week, including the malaria vaccine trials for Africa. But there's also this rotavirus, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, vaccine that's been developed by an Indian company and that Doctors Without Borders have helped do it with phenomenal success. And this is another a virus that's had a huge, huge mortality rate in Africa. Mm-hmm. I'm fascinated by the fact that an Indian company developed this and that the what they've done is according to reports, very, very inexpensive. What are we missing in our discussion today about the richness of what's going on outside of the United States in terms of drug activity and vaccine activity?
Yeah, so just with respect to that story, so the first rotavirus vaccines were developed by Merck and GSK, and they were licensed around 2006 in the United States, so it's now over 10 years after that. To Rip's point, this research that went into that vaccine, I know Merck started working on that vaccine in 1991 to get it licensed by 2006, and a major issue there was verifying the safety of the vaccines, 15
years.
Years, which Rip talked about. You know, having a pathway demonstrating that it was possible to make a rotavirus vaccine and that it was both efficacious and safe made it possible to think about other partnership models to increase global access to that vaccine. And while both Merck and GSK worked hard to enable global access, there is room for additional vaccine production, and there's a desire to have the vaccines be produced as affordably as possible, which is something that, you know, specific companies in India, like the one that did this, Serum Institute of India, have tremendous experience making high-quality, low-cost vaccines. And there's increasing partnership between the multinational pharmaceutical companies and so-called developing country manufacturers to really figure out how do you not only get vaccines to the wealthier countries, but how do you make them widely available in low-income countries as quickly as possible. And there too, it's like no one entity can do it on its own, and you need sort of strategic partnerships, strategic alliances between different sectors. And we're still kind of in early days in that regard. I think there are great examples like the one you mentioned, but we can do actually a lot better in
Rip,
the future.
Do you have any quick thoughts on the health of the international system?
I think points Mark's made are exactly spot on. The fact that the pathway had been demonstrated, that it was feasible, and we knew how to do the trials and what to look for, made the development of this particular vaccine much more compressed in time and was available really within a few years of actually production as opposed to the 10 years of development that it took GSK and Merck.
Well, I don't know about all of you, but I thought this was going to be a depressing conversation, and I'm actually very buoyed right now and hopeful. But let me open up the floor to those of you who have comments, questions. Yeah, our friend, yes?
Could the gap between 3 weeks and 10 years be shortened if there was a cap on the professional liability exposure that these pharmaceutical companies have and the really expensive exposure to insurance claims and medical professional liability if that were capped?
Fascinating question. Liability exposure, is that a big deal?
I mean, I think Merck and GSK had struggled to find a solution to this in the context of the Ebola response.
It's still not solved.
I mean, it is a gap. I don't think it's driving the time, but it is definitely an issue.
Fascinating. Other questions? Comments? Cool guys. Well, I want to thank you both. I think just before, since we've got a couple of minutes left, I'd really like to know from your joint experience. You know, I was joking at the beginning about both of you being competitors. I know how well you've collaborated, but in the broader, you know, pharmaceutical side, and I just want to be honest that, you know, I was in a charity performance in the Hill, a Shakespeare thing to raise money for kids, and a lot of senators and congressmen play on this, and I was assigned the role of Big Pharma. That was my title in the thing. And it was saying to, you know, to take on a Darth Vader-like voice. What do you think the public doesn't understand about your industry? Why does it seem, why do we joke about that in such a way and frame it? And what do you think from, since you're both industry insiders in a way, could be done to actually shift that perception if you think it's something that deserves to be shifted?
Well, we heard it already from the fellow from Regeneron, the incredible pride that employees within the company take about the work that we're doing, whether it's to develop a vaccine for malaria. And believe me, that has huge, huge internal, that resonates with people, say we are doing something good for humanity. Hmm. But it also extends to all of the vaccines, the 39 vaccines that GSK markets. They are all out there to help save lives, to help improve patient outcomes. This is why we're there. And I think that story is, while it resonates inside the company, I don't think we tell it very well to the external community.
Mark?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, not to say that pharmaceutical companies are uniformly good. They have, in certain instances, done things that I think many of them now think are regrettable, but I think a lot of things have changed. But it's the bad stories that get the media attention. The good stories, like the involvement in Ebola or like, you know, progress in treating HIV, would not have happened without pharmaceutical companies. You know, things like the Mectazan donation program that Claire referred to earlier. Those are programs that pharmaceutical companies made possible that are really addressing the needs of the poorest communities. There's no commercial return there, and I just think the better people understand those examples and recognize that the people who work for pharmaceutical companies have really, I think, a genuine commitment to do the right thing. I think we have to find models that make it easy for companies to really maximize the value they have to the public. And I think, you know, it's an issue of trust, which is very important, but it's an issue of understanding. And I think that's a role for the media to tell not only the bad stories, but the good stories, and hopefully encourage more good stories to not only come to fruition, but be widely appreciated. Because the only people who, I think everyone will benefit if there's a way for the pharma companies to be seen as good public citizens and for them to be the best public citizens they can possibly be.
I tried real hard, guys, but they're just too nice. So let's give a round of applause from Mark Feinberg, President and CEO of the International AIDS Vaccine Initiative, and Rick Ballew, Vice President of GSK Vaccines. Thank you both very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve, Ripley, and Mark. And for our last session this morning, we're going to look at some of the particular opportunities and challenges ahead for the genomic era, from bioethical concerns to public policy. And to illuminate these issues, we're pleased to be joined by Arthur Kaplan. He's Director of Medical Ethics and a Professor of Bioethics at New York University's Langone Medical Center. Welcome, Doctor. And Dr. Paul Applebaum is a psychiatrist and director of the Division of Law, Ethics, and Psychiatry at Columbia University, where he also teaches a course on genetics and the law. And Ting Wu is director and co-founder of the Personal Genetics Education Project and professor of genetics at Harvard Medical School. And welcome back, The Atlantic's James Hamblin.
So we're going to talk about challenges and opportunities, kind of with an ethical eye. Hopefully focus as much on opportunities as challenges, but there are a lot of both. I thought we'd start by picking up, we mentioned before 23andMe, this company where you can get your genome sequence, get the data given right to you, and you don't have to go through a clinician to do it. That raises a lot of questions that I wanted to hear each of your opinions on, especially if there's a strong one, and how that, because this is a challenge that's, a lot of what we're talking about is sort of abstract, and this is right before us right now. Should people be doing this? Should I be doing this? What's the good and bad?
Well, I have not been a big fan of 23andMe, partly because I worry that people are still going to spit in a cup. This is the spit in a cup, send it off to the company, get back information, sometimes about ancestry, sometimes about your disease risks. And I guess the FDA recently said that for 10 tests, they could do that without counseling, or they didn't need to have someone interpret the information. So the first point I would raise is I still don't believe that people know how to interpret genetic risk information. I think their doctors aren't sure, they're not sure. If somebody says to me, you have triple the risk of this disease, but the disease is exceedingly rare, it doesn't take a lot to make me worry about something that I shouldn't be. Second, I worry that some of the ancestry type stuff that they've done just doesn't have a good scientific base. It's sort of, you know, you see this guy on TV, the African American guy, in one of their ads, and he says, I found out that I'm from 40% from Central Africa, 20% from Southern Africa, 15% from West Africa kind of thing. And I'm thinking, well, I could have told you that. I didn't even need your DNA. It's sort of, yeah. But there's been a lot of migration. There's been a lot of population movement. It's not clear that trying to interpret where people's ancestry goes based on where people are now is the way to go. And then I'm worried, too, about who controls the DNA information. So you send it off to a private company. There's the tiny type that we're used to in lots of different agreements to get on the internet and stuff or use your cell phone program. But it sort of says, you know, we're going to take your DNA and we have your spit and we keep it. And we promise not to do bad stuff with it or release anything about you. But it doesn't mean that it can't be resold or someone couldn't step in and buy them. Or we don't have good rules still on the secondary, tertiary use of genetic information. So those are some worries.
And I'm going to guess that for all those reasons, 23andMe is not the future of personal genomics, and not just that company, but that model. We're seeing now a number of large health systems beginning to offer to the public at large what they call the healthy genome. That is, they're offering genome sequencing to people who aren't coming in looking for a diagnosis of an existing disorder, but want to be informed about their disease risk in general. In a context like that, you get not just your data dumped back in one bolus, but you get counseling, genetic counseling, as to what the implications of the data are, and you get the data fed into your electronic medical record and integrated into your medical care. Frankly, that seems like a much better model, and I'm just going to guess that that's the way we're headed in this business.
And your expertise is in policy, so do we need public policy that guides us in that direction and away from do-it-yourself?
So there's a place for government intervention. I'm not really sure we need it here. I think the market is going to drive this. And I think the advantages of having your physician and your health system do this for you and be prepared to use that data are going to seem so substantial to so many people that's where this is going to move. I think it's going to do it on its own.
Just to jump in there quickly, if it isn't integrated with your doctor and your health system, I don't think it's going to turn out to be that useful. I mean, it's not a curiosity. It's not some sort of fun thing to know your DNA. I mean, you could turn it into that if you want, but for practical reasons, you want it kind of where you get your health care, and that's where I think Paul's going.
Yeah, I'll jump in and say that I feel, I'll separate myself from 23andMe right now.
Sure.
And just say that even though the hospitals will be providing a lot of information, I know 23andMe is trying to provide more information, if we have a public that is more aware of what is going on, if that conversation were more vibrant, it may be that, I guess what I'm saying is I don't think we should underestimate the capacity of a public to understand what's going on in genetics if we just make that information more accessible. And at the Personal Genetics Education Project, we often talk about how, in spite of all the policies that may be put forth, and all the legal discussions and discussions of ethical issues, in the end, I think individuals make their own personal decision. And if they are more aware of what the issues are, what the opportunities are, and what the pitfalls are, that may be the best form of protection for them.
It may be, although you have some other issues that are cost-driven for justice, meaning 23andMe, they don't have a lot of minority people in their databases. People tend to pay the fee, and they tend to be upper class whites. And so if you're going to generalize and say, well, this is your risk, and you send your DNA in and you're Indian American or Korean American or Native American, I'm not sure you can generalize out just given the nature of how they build their information source. So I think we can teach people, you do it, to understand genetic information, but you got to make sure in the world of genetics that you have representative samples, that you have sufficient, you know, representation to let people then with confidence say, oh, that applies to me.
So I'm glad you brought that up. Participation is clearly key for all aspects, plain research and medicine. So this is anecdotal, but when we go to communities who are fairly well off, they tend to be generally very white, enriched.
And unvaccinated.
We'll tackle that in a moment. And you ask the audience, how many of you have heard of 23andMe, or how many of you have participated in 23andMe, you often see many hands go up. But when we go to communities that are underserved, communities where there's not that much wealth or opportunity, and we ask, who has heard of 23andMe? Remember, this is anecdotal. I can't give you stats on it yet. Very few hands, if any, go up. And so part of participation is just knowing what's going on. And I think that, so back again to having that conversation and raising awareness.
And you're dealing with overcoming historical elements of trust in the medical community and scientific establishment in some communities versus others. So you have to sort of, what sort of insights do you have in terms of tailoring messages and outreach to different historic contexts, different levels of scientific literacy, different yes. socioeconomic statuses. Is it even possible to do large-scale public outreach without like exacerbating divides?
I think yes. I think it's a lot easier than even I had anticipated when we started this project. I believe that people want to be heard. So when we go to underserved communities, I have experience walking into a room and feeling the anger, just the fact that I'm a scientist, just feeling the wall go up between me and the group. I think scientists sometimes come across as very haughty, very willing to justify our actions, we know better attitude, which is first of all not true. We don't know better. How can we know better about the population if we don't talk to the population? And so what we do is we go into the audience not trying to sell anything. We don't promote genetics. We don't promote technologies. What we want to do is let people know that we have information if they're interested to please come talk with us. And we bring up the sticky social ethical issues. Sometimes our audience just gets into an argument. But somehow through that argument, having them have voice lowers that distrust and starts a conversation.
If we're going to reach the general population, I mean, it sounds like you're using face-to-face approaches, but that's limited because you can't get 310 million people in a room with you over time. So. At Columbia, one of my colleagues has been developing little videos, and she now has a library of them, Wendy Chung, who you may know, of different aspects of genetic testing, genomic sequencing, the kinds of results that could come up. We've got them in English. We have most of them in Spanish now. They're available online, they are scalable because they can things like this can be creative approaches can be disseminated to the entire population without necessarily requiring people to come into the room where you happen to be at that moment in time.
We love that. I applaud that. We also are. I think we can work with the television and film industry, which we do. Producers and writers of feature films and television. They are. I feel. More and more interested in the genetic world. And they are artists in reaching the community and involving them.
So let me shed a little horror on that, working with Hollywood. Just this past weekend, we saw the HBO documentary come out on Henrietta Lacks. That's a story, for those of you who don't know, of a woman who had a tumor removed in 1951 and basically it was studied and turned into HeLa cells, which are used a lot in research and have been commercially useful to companies as well. Her children and descendants felt that they were not told about what was going on and felt exploited. So the message of this, I think, widely seen show, because Oprah is in it, is that science will exploit you. There isn't much of a discussion of the fact that we did put in ethics rules. We have informed consent for getting samples today. You wouldn't have a Henrietta Lacks situation. Even the book, which is probably the biggest, most widely read book about genetics, Rebecca Skloot's book, ends without discussion of what the ethics protections have been since then. So I worry, I mean, what Hollywood likes too is Jurassic Park. That was pretty scary. I happen to like gene drives. I think we should use them to get rid of, you know, mosquito-borne illnesses, but it's hard to do if everybody thinks that something's going to come out of the sewer and kill them because they just saw it in a TV show or a Hollywood movie.
Dr. Wu, you worked with Grey's Anatomy. How did you approach that? That show has a tendency, I remember one episode, there was a bomb inside of a gentleman's chest. They have a patient, this was a code black. They have a tendency to, you know, make over-dramatize. How did you steer away from that in working with them?
So I guess I'll say it's a conversation. It's a back and forth. It's a case of checks and balances. I think when people get up and argue, that's great. I think people who've been hurt have a chance to get angry, that's great. So now to answer your question, it took me a while to learn how to work with the Hollywood Health and Society and the Science and Entertainment Exchange of the National Academy of Sciences. These groups put scientists in touch with the producers and writers. In the beginning, I would answer questions. Very often you don't know who you're talking to. It's a very secret process, producing scripts. But eventually I got to know Grey's Anatomy, and the person who was coaching me said, I had complained about a particular phrase, or dramatizing, or shortening the process of a scientific experiment or analysis. And she took me aside and said, okay, you think you know how to do this? And I said, well, I think I could have worded it better. She goes, give me a sentence that will, the way you think this doctor should have said this. So I said it, and she goes, now why are you working with us? I said, because I'm really trying to reach the public in a scalable way. And she said, okay, I just want to tell you, you just lost 3 million viewers by the way you said that. You make a decision. Are you trying to reach people? Are you trying to say it the correct way? And I was convinced. We can fix some of these things. The CDC tracks the kinds of phone calls they get after a Grey's Anatomy show. They have a collaboration. And when Grey's Anatomy touches on a disease, the phone calls to the CDC go up.
Everyone thinks they
have it. Well, that I don't know. But they call. So, but I hear what you're saying. It's complicated.
You know, we thinking for the future, we also need to think about moving back chronologically on the age span and the ways in which we're educating students in, you know, from elementary school on about genomics and its current understanding and its place in medicine and the world. And all the evidence suggests we're not, in general, doing a very good job with that now, even in college biology and genetics classes. And there's no question the field's moving quickly. Everything I learned in medical school is not just outdated, most of it's wrong today. We now have entirely different conceptualizations of the way the genome works. So this has to be a multifaceted effort. Yes. Educational system, the public at large, and physicians as well. We heard in one of the earlier panels just how badly our colleagues do in terms of understanding what the implications of genomic results are for their patients.
So how does any given individual keep up with it? Do we need policy implications for medical education, for public schools to integrate genetics? I mean, what's the solution? Well,
there's no, I don't think there's one solution,
right?
The clearly educational, and there's no unified educational policy in this country, right? So school boards, school districts, states need to take the initiative in recognizing the importance of this material and developing curricula or engaging scientists and thought leaders to develop curricula to make sure that it's done well.
I think that scientists fail their moral obligation to engage the community. For every one of these experiments in public education, there are thousands of scientists who say, I don't do that. I don't talk to the public. I don't get involved. It's not my job. We just had the greatest nerd march ever seen in Washington, which was good, but we haven't seen that before. A lot of people said we shouldn't be political. My view is, of course you have to be political. You have to fight for money to be spent on you. You don't have to be political in the sense of, you know, getting into debates about policy, about how the information is applied, but you've got to be political if you want the public to support it. We're seeing the results of sort of hiding in the ivory tower. They won't, and especially if they don't understand it. So a key step for me is, where's the public understanding of science? Where do we train scientists to write that sentence or communicate more clearly? Now, not everybody's good at everything, I understand that, but at least some pathway. I'll end this little screed by saying, we have a bioethics program at NYU. If I go to the basic science department, not the doctors, but the basic science department, say I'd like to have somebody spend a month or 6 months learning about the bioethical issues so they can engage in the debate and communicate about them, the lab director's gonna go out of his or her mind and say, a month away from the bench? Absolutely can't happen. It's ridiculous. No, it's, you know, and we don't want that. So we don't have the troops. You know, people say, well, there's Carl Sagan, and there was Stephen Jay Gould, and there's other prominent scientists who do this, but you could name them on two hands. That's not enough.
Well, I could, there's a little uptick. There may be a slight change in our culture. So the PGED, which I direct, actually is a nonprofit part of my, well, actually my whole lab is nonprofit, but it's a part of my research lab. And several years ago, we sort of lived off some of the funding I was able to scrounge up. We were about to go under. And the chair of my department, Cliff Taven, it is a research department, came to me and said that he felt the obligation to reach the public was especially important in genetics departments. And he diverted a large sum of research funding to support reaching out to the public. And I feel in the past few months, there's been a slight change. When I go give research talks in other departments of genetics, I've had faculty and students come up wanting to do a similar thing. I think geneticists, in particular geneticists, are starting to feel and starting to act on this sense of responsibility. So maybe it's going to get better.
So there's a level at which we're not doing that today that maybe we need to think about doing it. And that's at the National Institutes of Health. If you talk to program directors up to institute directors, they'll tell you that public education is not their mission, that their mission is supporting research. Some of them, if they're being blunt over a beer, will say that public education is a sinkhole. You could pour infinite amounts of money into it and they just don't have the funding to do it. Well, you know, maybe that's not the right attitude for the 21st century. Maybe public education has to be part and parcel of what NIH and related agencies like NSF, National Science Foundation, can support. It may be just that important now that they should be doing that.
Yes, and I think that is starting to change at NIH too. It's a really encouraging time, I feel. But we can't stop. We have to scale and escalate this.
I'd add a plug for journalism too. Just making yourself available for comment and being on social media. It's so easy. You don't have to launch a huge program to start a Twitter account and engage. When I was doing my residency at UCLA, Twitter was blocked. This was in 2012, but you couldn't. It was a UCLA medical center. You couldn't use Twitter on any of their computers because it was a waste of time. and maybe it is. But there are many legitimate uses that I think medical establishment is sort of coming around to now late in the game when does Trump have 20 million followers?
We even try to get people, and I think the medical school is a little bit easier than the hard science line right now, but it's sort of, you should be able to graduate with a PhD or an MD and at least write a letter to the editor that's cogent or an op-ed piece or put together a blog statement. It's a skill set, and we ought to empower people to have those skills too. They are communicators. It's part of what I think if you take public funding, you should give back to the public. We now insist that you make your results available at clinicaltrials.gov, but that's nice, but I think relatively few people will go there to read them. So being able to communicate, you know, information about what you're doing.
And there are models. So for example, in our residency program, there's an elective course that the residents can take that culminates in their writing an op-ed. Now they may or may not get it published, but the idea mm-hmm. is there are journalists involved and psychiatrists involved to teach them something about how to communicate with the public. And that is something that, you know, it's great it's in one program, but there's no reason why physicians and basic scientists couldn't have similar experiences during their training.
Yeah, it seems like a requirement of a lot of these events that we end on, the solution is public education. So we're here right now. But we kind of skipped over discussion of the ethics of what I hear a lot when I'm talking to people who don't know as much about genetics, and that is sort of the designer baby question, the end use of genome editing, of the potential worst case scenarios. So I think that's a good question for at least people in the room to consider how to respond to and how to think about. How do you talk about that when you're having dinner with a friend who's not an expert in
this? So it's important to recognize there are two broad uses of gene editing in humans, right?
Yeah.
One is to edit somatic genes that are disease-causing in an effort to treat a disorder that somebody has. And the second is to edit the germline to prevent that person from passing on a predisposition to a disorder to their offspring. With all the controversy over gene editing, that first use for the treatment of existing diseases tends to be relatively uncontroversial, and I think that's important to recognize.
By the way, I have to add, somatic cell gene editing is not controversial, I would agree, when it's in humans. It's hugely controversial when it's plants or animals.
Because we're messing with nature?
Yeah, and we're used to the idea that medicine intervenes with us, but if I say, how about GMO food? We're gonna, you know, alter some genes and make healthier food or food that can fight off pests, or we're gonna make animals that will have less waste or less nitrogen in their waste or whatever. People are, well, I don't know that you should do that. You can engineer me,
right,
but not my dog.
Well, why is it that people tend to take, I guess, these black or white, I'm for editing or I'm not type statements instead of the use case scenario type, you know, if we could use it to cure this disease or this one particular case, but I also wouldn't want to make designer babies.
Talked a little about history in human germline engineering, changing our reproductive future. We have a past. It's the Nazi race hygiene eugenics programs. It's sterilization programs, bans on interracial marriage in various states in the U.S. and countries. We have a pretty grim past with respect to controlling reproduction when it comes to genetics. It's not good. And it casts a shadow over how we think about where we're going. On the other hand, it does seem to me you want to make sure that people are focused on gene editing, as Paul said before I interrupted him. You're going to try and fix diseases, whether it's somatic cell or hereditary, you know, passing on hemophilia, passing on other terrible genetic afflictions. That seems to me to be where the focus is. I don't think we need to argue about how tall we should engineer our babies or whether we should make them with supervision or, you know, powers beyond imagination. We're not there yet. That's an issue for one generation, maybe two away right now. But trying to come up with the rules about how to safely proceed to fix disease, whether it's somatic or germline, that seems to me to be the way to get the public involved and calm about it.
And to your question, why are people as upset and black and white about it as they are? I think we're dealing with a slippery slope perception here, that once you start fooling with the germline, that there's no stopping point. But of course, we can create stopping points. We don't have to go from editing a predisposition to Huntington's disease to editing eye color or running ability, athletic ability. We can come up with reasonable rules, as I think Art is suggesting, and begin to address this. And frankly, I think it's inevitable that we will, because the technology, once it's perfected, is so powerful that it's almost inconceivable that it won't be utilized.
And a little twist to that is whether when we have these discussions and set up these rules, whether it's an international effort or separate nation by nation.
We have time for two or three questions.
Hey, how are you? My name is Lippy Roy. Thank you for the fascinating panel. I'm an internist and an addiction medicine doctor. I oversee addiction efforts at New York City jails, including Rikers. I'm a strong advocate of technology, science, and innovation, but I think it's really important to take that into consideration with the complex medical and psychosocial aspects that affect health. So prior to this role, I was a doctor of Boston's homeless population, leading cause of death of drug overdose. So you can treat their cancer and their Alzheimer's and their Huntington's, but if you don't recognize that, they're more concerned about their next meal or where they're sleeping tonight. So how is the best way or most effective way to leverage, you know, the power and authority and funding sources of, like, say, industry and government to really recognize that these other aspects of health matter in terms of health outcomes? Thanks.
Well, I'll jump into that because I have sympathy for that comment in that I think when we get obsessed about genetics, we overlook the fact that one way to treat your asthma is to clean up the air, not just engineer your lung cells or something like that. So it is still true that for a lot of Americans, they don't have basic health care. Genomics a little bit looks like a luxury. If you have, you know, empowered, you have resources, you can go worry about minor genetic risks. But clearly for most people, they want to manage their diabetes or be able to access healthy food or be able to get some exercise somewhere or manage their drug problems, have a safe place to sleep and so on. Those still have to be the priorities, I think, in the health system and how we spend our money. I'm not against moving us along genetically, but we don't have a system that would get the best yield for the dollar right now in terms of health. That remains a problem.
This stuff is a tool, the things we're talking about today, right? Just like an MRI machine is a tool. Nobody expects MRI to solve all the problems in healthcare. And we have to be careful not to oversell personalized genomic medicine, right? It's not going to solve all the problems in healthcare for exactly the reasons that you point out. So it's one more tool, keep it in perspective. It's not what we're going to spend all our money on. But it's conceivable that for some substantial number of people, this could be a very useful tool.
Yeah. Another question? Someone over there? Oh, sorry, back here.
Hi, I'm David Keefe. I'm from NYU Langone Medical Center. I have a question about communicating genomics information. You were taught in our medical training, first do no harm. But words can be like knives, they can be like scalpels. And I can remember how I was trained to do ultrasound when it was beginning, back when I was a trainee at Yale. And I remember the way not to do it, which was to say, oh, wait a minute, that there's something there. Oh, looks like cancer. Oh, no, forget that, not cancer, just a tumor. No. It's nothing, you know, so that's how not to do it. How do you communicate these sort of continuous outcomes, the risk, when people don't really think that way?
So there are so many terms, statistics, that make it difficult to discuss genetics the way we think it should be discussed. We have found that the biggest problem is getting people to want to even have that discussion. And so when we go to communities, we actually, I almost never say GATC, I never say dominant recessive, I rarely actually talk about a specific variant for a disease. I simply talk about the ethical social issues, especially in communities that have been disenfranchised. They start discussing whether it's good or bad, and that leads to questions that are relevant to them. And then I know what actually to answer for them. These days, for communities that, you know, not all of them have the ability to get to the internet, they then can go get that information. But we find the most important thing is to make it a safe conversation and one where they feel totally involved.
And although at first there was a lot of concern that giving genomic information back to patients would be upsetting to them, provoke depression, suicide attempts, and this is what people were worried about when people found out about predispositions to future illness. That seems to have been markedly overblown, if you will. People do reasonably well with this information, and so our communication should be good, but it doesn't have to be perfect. We're not going to destroy people's lives by using the wrong word to communicate the findings.
We can do one more. Yes.
Hi, I'm Lisa. I'm a consumer. I think there's tremendous value both in terms of understanding as a consumer how I can make behavioral changes to be healthier longer, as well as getting vital treatment if I need it. But this information feels like it could also be very damaging in terms of the cost impact of just when I may find out I need care, my health insurance or my supplemental health insurances become unaffordable to me because I just became a high-risk person. What are your thoughts about the ethics and the balance of the cost versus the knowledge that consumers will be able to have in the future?
Well, remember, a lot of the burden of protecting against discrimination or adverse events from finding out genetic information, we hoped would be solved by passing laws like GINA, the Genetic Non-Discrimination Act for health insurance. That's helped. Obamacare did have its pre-existing condition restriction that you shouldn't try to underwrite out people with prior problems, and I think that's useful, although we'll see if it endures, but I think it's a good thing. It's trying to share the risk in the community, basically, rather than assign it to those who know they have risk. But there's still problems with disability insurance. There's still problems with things like life insurance. There's still issues about employment, depending on where you are, small employers versus bigger ones that are covered by these protections. So I know Jim was interested in sort of things we could do. If you want to see genetic testing flourish down the road, I do think you have to repair some of these, through legislation, some of these adverse consequences of going out to get or to know information. You know, we've even had situations where in some parts of the world, people won't marry somebody else unless they take a genetic test, because they're worried that they pay for the hospitals. I'm talking about the island of Cyprus here, if any of you are interested, at least the Greek part. And the Greek Orthodox Church runs the hospitals, and they don't want people getting thalassemia and other costly genetic diseases. Now, I'm not saying it's necessarily wrong to do that, but you want to debate that kind of consequence and sort of saying, you know, I can't get married in the church because, is that okay? Down the road, genetic discrimination could extend to, I'm an Ashkenazi Jewish woman, I'm at high risk of breast cancer, so I'm going to underwrite out the whole group, not the individual, but I'll just penalize a population. So I know you were looking for some answers. These are places where I think work reasonably can be done that won't hinder the evolution of genetics, but would help it.
And in terms of what you can do today, there's a new proposal out for abrogating the Affordable Care Act. It came out while we were here this morning. If you haven't contacted your Congress people about this yet, go do it, because we're moving backwards if we go in that direction rather than forwards.
On that note, thank you so much to our panelists, Dr. Kaplan, Dr. Applebaum, Dr. Wu.
Thank you, Art, Paul, Ting, and Jim. That was a rich way to end the day, where we heard about everything from the needs for support for medical research, the power of science to improve the human condition and health access for the poorest among us. We talked about the ethical, legal, and societal implications of genomics, and we even learned about the impact of Gray's Anatomy on people's understanding of medical science. These are all vital issues that we will continue to follow. Thanks so much to all our speakers, our moderators this morning. And I'd like to thank our underwriter, Pharma, for making this Atlantic Forum possible. Mostly, I'd like to thank everybody who came and spent their morning with us. We know how valuable your time is, so thank you for giving so much of it to us. In the meantime, one request before you dash out. You have on your chairs, or you will get an email from me shortly, a quick survey about this morning forum, this morning's forum. I would love you to fill it out. Your feedback is so important to us and actually helps inform our work. With that, have a wonderful day. Stay dry.